The plan of salvation has strengthened my testimony of the scriptures and firmed up my belief in the divinity of the Savior. We have our Heavenly Father's guidance while journeying through this life. Bruce R. McConkie said, the plan of salvation originated with the Father. He is the author and finisher of our faith in the final sense. He ordained the laws by obedience to which we and Christ become like Him. Here's a Heavenly Father's gospel plan. It becomes the gospel of Son by adoption, and the plan is called after Christ's name because of His atonement and His sacrifice. Who is the Savior and what does His sacrifice mean to man? Jesus was considered the Prince of Peace, Lord and Master. Christ was born the son of a carpenter, and as He grew physically and spiritually, Jesus understood the scriptures because they testified of Him as the great Messiah. At the age of 10, Jesus was teaching in the temple and doing the will of His Father, Heavenly Father. Because of the Savior's love for us, He suffered greatly. The Savior suffered criticism from the hypocrites and the taunts of the wicked. However, the Savior did many acts of mercy, including raising the dead, healing the sick, forgiving the repentant, teaching love and charity and repentance to the common man, expounding the virtues of humility, and showing the way home. The Savior is obedient to Heavenly Father. Obedience is the first law of heaven, and Christ was the perfect example of obedience. While on the cross, Jesus did not cry out for escape, but suffered for us in silence. The Savior did the will of the Father and answered the laws of justice. Christ's pattern of obedience is our pattern to follow. We glorify God through obedience in our labors and callings. It is our goal to strive to become like Jesus. The Father and Son are alike in their divine attributes, actions, beliefs, and truths. The salvation of the Lord makes possible the gifts of eternal life and the chance to be ahead as of an eternal family. In D&C 93:19-20, for if you keep my commandments, you shall receive of His fullness and be glorified in me, even as I am in the Father. Therefore I say unto you, you shall receive grace from grace. We do not walk the road of life alone. The Savior is helping us all along the way. We are blind to His presence because of our unbelief. Our belief and actions created the rift. The Savior will not leave us if we are righteous. The prophet Nephi talked with the Lord. Nephi believed the words of his father, Lehi, concerning the life and teachings of this Lord. Nephi received a witness that Lehi's teachings and prophecies were true. Nephi demonstrated at a young age he was obedient to the commandments of God. A changing point in Nephi's life occurred when he asked God if the words and dreams of Lehi were true. Nephi asked Heavenly Father to give him understanding. Nephi was receptive to the receiving revelation. Nephi received a confirmation that his father spoke the truth. Nephi was allowed to see the dream of the tree of life. Nephi received the knowledge of the fruit of the tree, a fruit that can produce exceeding joy. The fruit represented the love of God and was available to all mankind. Nephi must have felt sorrow and pain when he saw so many people rejecting the fruit of the tree of life because of the pride of the world. Nephi saw many people wandering off the straight and narrow path. The iron rod is the only way to travel to the tree of life. The wanderers were lost in the world, aimlessly searching for happiness. Without an iron rod, man would not find their salvation, nor would they escape various degrees of destruction due to unrighteousness. The filthy water rivers of war would plague mankind and confuse and discourage even the strong men, as did Laban and Lemuel. Failure is an awful word. Do we become discouraged when everything else seems to be going wrong and throw our hands up in the air and say, I can't go on? We should never yield to or give attention to negative thoughts that cause fear. Everything can be an asset and used to help us grow. Webster defines failure as a falling short, a deficiency or lack. We are children of God. We are doers of the word and not hearers only. We need to pray to God for help and make us more like the Savior, for divine help to overcome temptation. We learn by obedience. If you love me, keep my commandments. We need to be patient. We should not become discouraged if things don't go our way. We should believe things are right around the corner. Satan delights in frustration, discontentment, and confusion. Sometimes we can take a step back and try again. We can gain insight and comprehension by reading about how others have overcome their adversities. We can become determined to accomplish the task and get lost in the service of the process. We can pray to the Lord to bless us with courage to endure this process of change. We need to work hard. We need to work hard for the things we desire and want to gain. Laziness and idleness lead to destruction. Why were the Lamanites so desirous to gain control over the Nephites and plunder resources of the Nephites? Why did the Lamanites believe enslaving the Nephites would lead to a better life? Slavery does not work because it lacks the incentive structure for high levels of creativity, innovation, and productivity. The price of idleness is bondage and unrighteous dominion. We need to have faith in a cause and work to make our dreams become a reality. Productivity is a sign of work and results in the feeling of satisfaction. Faith helps us to be of good cheer and enthusiastic about our dreams. We should take action today to change the realities of tomorrow. Cooperation is better than competition and contention. Contention is destructive. We should be grateful for the things which the Lord has given us. We owe our lives, our wealth, and everything to the Lord. If we were grateful, could we ever look at the needs of our brother and ignore them? Would the Lord give to the needy if he were here? Is it easy to become proud instead of being humble? Should we thank the Lord for all he has granted us and realize that we have what we have can be all that can be taken? Can we do good with material wealth to help our brothers in need? Anonymous gifts of charity, welfare, contributions, time, and resource, gifting to the missionary funds. We should use wise discretion of our choices. We should liken the scriptures to ourselves. Nephi said, I do liken the scriptures unto us that it might be unto our learning and profit. We can gain truth and build upon itself to gain greater truths. Isaiah tells us not to be unwise about knowledge. Oh, the cunning plan of the evil one, oh, the vainness and frailties and the foolishness of men. When they are learned, they think they are wise, and when they hearken not unto the counsels of God, for they set it aside. Suppose they know of themselves, wherefore their wisdom is foolishness, and it profit them nothing, and they shall perish. 2 Nephi 9:28. We should use knowledge to gain wisdom. Wisdom can teach, bless the lives of others. We should pray for inspiration and abide the influence of the Holy Ghost in our lives. The Holy Ghost can teach us light and truth, and seek after these things is both beautiful and praiseworthy. Many brilliant people in the world know little about God. They do not understand or see the face to face with God, and so they suppose they cannot be a God. While others argue that there is a God, he would not be so unjust. Others will say to me, show me a sign, prove to me there is a God. Moroni 10:4. And you shall receive these things. I would exhort you that you would ask God, the Eternal Father, in the name of Christ, if these things are not true. And if you ask with a sincere heart, with real intent, having faith in Christ, he will manifest the truth of it unto you by the power of the Holy Ghost. These scriptures further tell us, and they that believe him shall not be destroyed, both by fire and earthquake and bloodshed, by pestilence and famine. And they shall know the Lord is God, the Holy One of Israel. 2 Nephi 6:14-15. We will be judged by the Savior. He is the Savior, spoken of by the prophets, both ancient and modern. God is a God of love. Our Heavenly Father loves us so much, he gave his only begotten Son to die for us. If we believe in him, we would not perish, but have everlasting life. All things depend on the Lord. And if you say that there is no law, you have say there is no sin. If you say there is no sin, you say there is no righteousness. And if you shall say there is no righteousness, there is no happiness. And if there be no happiness nor righteousness, there can be no punishment or misery. And if these things are not, then there is not a God. And if there is not a God, we are not, neither earth, for there can be have been no creation of things, neither act or to be acted upon. Wherefore all things must vanish away. 2 Nephi 2:13. We need to learn effective communication. We make mistakes, but we should learn to resolve problems and concerns. Communication is a tool to help solve problems. The Lord will reveal many marvelous things unto us, and sometimes the revelations will take time to comprehend completely. The insights may take years to understand completely. If we repent, we can expect to be forgiven. We can enjoy the feeling of humility after we are forgiven. We can feel the burning power of God after becoming sanctified and clean. We will have praise God for opening our eyes and removing our guilt and remorse. We will no longer desire to do evil. We will realize the Savior is our rock of our salvation. How many times could the Lamanites and Nephites have been spared destruction if they would have listened to the words of the prophet? A prophet is a mouthpiece of the Lord and receives revelation to guide the Lord's people. So often we take lightly the words of the prophet when it does not agree with our belief systems. A prophet preaches against the doctrine of eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. We should not deny our testimony of the truth. We need to stand up for freedom, truth, and light. Perfect love casts out fear. We should love the Lord with all our heart, mind, and strength, and endure to the end, and not yield to the temptations of the devil. We shall pray for deliverance from adversity. We shall be engaged in dreams that will be profitable and avoid the pitfalls that will discourage us. 2 Nephi 33:11-14. 11. And if they are not the words of Christ, judge ye, for Christ will show unto you with power and great glory that they are his words at the last day. And you and I shall stand face to face before his bar, and ye shall know that I have commanded of him to write these things, notwithstanding my witness. 14. And you that will not be part of the goodness of God, and respect the words of the Jews, and also the words and words which shall proceed forth out of the mouth of the Lamb of God, behold, I will bid you an everlasting farewell. For these words shall condemn you at the last day, and ye shall prove the Book of Mormon words are true with great power and glory at the last day. The Lord will be our judge, and he will judge all mankind, and he admonishes the righteous saints to continue in righteousness, to be faithful and endure to the end, and he convincingly warns the wicked to repent and stop hating him and cease from the rebellion and seek a mission into the kingdom of God. And battle against good and evil is the contest between the unbelievers and God, and he will prove the words of the Book of Mormon are true with great power and glory. The unbeliever will be without defense as the power and glory of God is manifest and proven. The innocent will be vindicated, the saints will be quickened, and the wicked destroyed with fire. Moroni 10:27. I exhort you to remember these things, for the time speedily cometh that ye shall know that I lie not. For ye shall see me at the bar of God, and the Lord God will say unto you, Did I not declare my words unto you, which were written by this man, like as one crying from the dead, yea, even as one speaking out of the dust? Moroni testifies that he was a witness of the judgment, that the word of Christ written in the Book of Mormon are true. The punishment of the law demands justice is not robbed. Moroni teaches that those who die in their sins will not escape justice through the mercy of God. He can give and obtain mercy in his life. The Lord wants to provide mercy, and he has the ability to pay the ransom of justice. Justice cannot be robbed by mercy. The word and law of Christ described in the Book of Mormon will bear testimony against the sins, and justice will claim the creature. These words are a sharp rebuke for the wicked to repent and avoid the awful monster of justice. Ignorance is not a defense against the claims of a breaking the law. Today is a day of probation, a time to prepare to meet God, a time to repent. Failure to read and study the Book of Mormon is no justification to escape the laws binding to the inhabitants of earth. Therefore, both member and non-member are under condemnation by not studying and applying the teachings of the Book of Mormon. 2 Nephi 28:29. Woe be unto him that shall say, We have received the word of God, and we need no more of the word of God, for we have enough. Whenever the Lord uses woe, he indicates sharp warning, a warning so severe that if it is ignored, the wrath of God and the calamities of the wicked are sure to follow. 2 Nephi 29:3-11. A Bible, a Bible, we've got a Bible, we need no more Bible. The Lord teaches that in the mouth of two or more witnesses, the truth is established. God does not favor one nation over another. He is no respecter of person. The canon of scripture writings would prove that God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, unalterable and unchanged. Ether 12:23-27. The Lord, the Gentiles will mock at these things because of our weakness in writing, for the Lord hath made us mighty in word for faith. I fear the Gentiles will mock us at our words. 26. And when I had said this, the Lord spake unto me, said, Fools mock, but they shall mourn, and in my grace is sufficient for the meek, that there shall me take no advantage of your weakness. The wisdom of the wise shall perish, the learned who hearken not to the Lord will fall, and the meek shall inherit the earth. I believe in the prophecy that the meek inherit the earth, also suggests that the meek will receive celestial inheritance. Interestingly, the meek will be blessed with the grace of God to understand the words of the Book of Mormon. Mormon 8:16-17. 16. And blessed is he that shall bring this thing to light, for it shall be brought out of darkness into light according to the word of God. Yea, it shall be brought out of the earth, and it shall shine forth out of darkness, and come unto the knowledge of the people, and it shall be done by the power of God. 17. He that condemneth, let him be aware, lest he shall be in danger of hellfire. The Book of Mormon is not to be condemned. Those who chose to condemn the Book of Mormon rashly tempted God, or smiteth the righteous, bringing judgment against themselves. Oppose and resist secret combinations. Ether 8:18-26. Murder for gain is abominable to the Lord. Mormon 8:26-41. The cries of the slain saints will cry up for justice, and the Lord will be unable to turn a deaf ear to their cries. The wrath of God will sweep the wicked from the earth. We are to hope that there is sufficient time for the wicked to repent before the great and dreadful day of the Lord. Time is mercy because it gives the wicked an opportunity to see the error of their ways, the lack of fruit in the lies that they believe, and the craftiness and deceptions of man. The wild branches need time to be grafted into the tame fruit of the tree and start producing good fruit. The Book of Mormon is a type of our day. Murder for gain or theft is the driving force behind war. Scarcity is the product of war and not the forces of free market systems. Righteous moral belief systems abhor war and considerate methods and effects evil. I do not believe Jesus delights in the conflicts and wars of men, and I do not believe that in the last century man has been justified in the cause of war. War is only justified when revealed by the Lord is commanding man to fight and kill. Without God is man fighting and killing because they have forgotten the teachings of Jesus. Listen to the anguish of Mormon. Mormon 6, 17 through 22. 17, O ye fair ones, how could you have departed from the ways of the Lord? O ye fair ones, how could you have rejected the Jesus who stood with you in open arms to receive you? Behold, if ye had done this, ye would have not fallen. But behold, ye are fallen, I mourn your loss. O ye fair sons and daughters, ye fathers and mothers, ye husbands and wives, ye fair ones, how is it that ye have fallen? But behold, ye are gone, my sorrows cannot bring you your return. And the day cometh when your mortal must put on immortality, and these bodies are now moultering in corruption, must become incorruptible bodies. Then you must stand before the judgment seat of Christ to be judged according to your works. And if they be righteous, then you are blessed with your fathers who have gone before you. Oh, that ye had repented, for this great destruction had come upon you. Behold, ye are gone, and the Father, yea, the eternal Father of heaven, knoweth your state, and he doeth them with him according to his justice and mercy. Pride goes to leads to the fall of civilizations. Mormon 8:27. Pride destroys the Nephites. 2 Nephi 28:15-16. The proud are puffed up. They teach false doctrines, commit whoredoms, pervert the right ways of the Lord. The proud are full of iniquity, ripe for destruction. The rotten fruit analogy versus the beautiful fruit analogy should be the focal point. The righteous have a radiant countenance, bright and illuminated like the crystal lights of a beautiful light. The righteous radiate with happiness, contentment, and intelligence that they are delighted to behold. The fruit of the tree can be directly witnessed by the countenance and righteousness of the saints. The inner light is so transparent they can see and glorify our Father in heaven. In contrast, the rotten fruit demonstrates a countenance of anger, pride, arrogance, deception. A rotten fruit cannot bring forth good fruit. A rotten tree cannot bring forth good fruit. Alma 32:14. Blessed are they who are not compelled to be humble. Pride leads to the fall because a untruth hypothesis is undefendable and irrational. The mind cannot grasp and sustain a lie indefinitely. The pain associated with embracing a lie will eventually cause the individual to abandon the lie. Interestingly, as the group discovers and abandons the lie, the force of the lie diminishes and the individual experiences liberty and freedom from tyranny. As truth is revealed, stronger and more compelling forces substitute and dissolve the lie. The power of truth is so tremendous that the complete system based on pride will dissolve instantaneously. The individual can repent and turn from their error, or they can be destroyed by the consequences of evil. The Lord understands our case and has pleaded before us if we will discover the truth, we will find that he is carefully orchestrating events designed to assist in our success. Destruction only occurs when individual is rotten and the devil has sealed his servants as his own. At that point, there is no use to trying to redeem the bad fruit. The fruit is only salvageable in the early stages of sin. The Lord warns about the curse of unbelief. Mormon 9:7-10. The Lord speaks against those who deny the revelations of God, telling them if they will willfully deny revelations, prophecies, gifts, healing, speaking in tongues, and interpretation in tongues, they must think God is unchangeable. Furthermore, these individuals must think God is not a God of miracles. Therefore, deny the power of God exists. Mormon 9:15-21. Miracles cease because of unbelief. Moroni 7:37-38. It is by faith that miracles are wrought. Man must have faith in God because of meekness. If they do not have faith in God, then we are not fit for membership in his church. Moroni 10:24-34. If the day comes that the power and gifts of God are done away with, it will be because of unbelief, and those who do good possess the gift and power of God to act. 30. And again, I would exhort you that when you come unto Christ and lay hold upon every good gift, and touch not the evil gift, nor the unclean thing. 31. And awake and arise from the dust, O Jerusalem. Yea, and put on thy beautiful garments, O daughter of Zion, and strengthen thy stakes and enlarge in thy borders forever. The priesthood is the power and glory of God to manifest through actions of the worthy priesthood holders. The glory of God is intelligence. Priesthood holders are to act and not be acted upon. A good measure of faith is required to act. A priesthood holder should invoke the powers of heaven rather than passively request assistance. The priest of Levi exercised great faith by stepping into the waters of Jordan before the river parted and crossed over on dry ground. Faith must precede the miracle. Mormon 9:2-5 to the unbeliever. Behold, ye believe in the day of your visitation. Behold, when the Lord shall come, yea, even that great day when the earth shall be rolled together as a scroll, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Yea, in that great day ye shall be brought to stand before the Lamb of God. Then ye shall say that there is no God. Behold, ye shall be brought to see your nakedness before God, and the glory of God, and the holiness of Jesus Christ. It will kindle a flame of unquenchable fire upon you. O then, unbelieving, turn ye unto the Lord, cry mightily unto the Father in the name of Jesus, that perhaps ye may be found spotless, pure, fair, white, having been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb at the last day. Mormon 5:22-24. And then, O ye Gentiles, how can ye stand before the power of God except ye repent and turn from your evil ways? Know ye not that ye are in the hands of God? Know ye not that he hath power and his great command that the earth shall roll together as a scroll? Therefore repent ye, humble yourself before him, lest ye come out of justice against you, lest a remnant of the seed of Jacob shall go forth among you as a lion and tear you into pieces, and there is none to deliver. In summary, the Book of Mormon: deny not the power of God. Jesus is the Christ. Beware of pride. Flee from the wickedness of secret combinations. Repent and be baptized. Be judged out of the book given to us by God, including the Book of Mormon. Mormon 6, verse 7. O ye fair ones, how could ye have departed from the ways of the Lord? O ye fair ones, how could ye have rejected the Jesus who stood with you open arms to receive you? Behold, if you had not done this, you would have not fallen. Behold, ye are fallen, and I mourn your loss. Ye fair sons and daughters, ye fathers and mothers, ye husbands and wives, ye fair ones, how is it that ye could have fallen? But behold, ye are gone, and my sorrows cannot bring you return. And the day soon cometh that your mortals shall put on immortality, and these bodies shall now molder in corruption, must soon become incorruptible bodies. And then ye must stand before the judgment seat of Christ to be judged according to your works. And if it so be that ye are righteous, then are ye blessed with your fathers who have gone before you. Oh, that ye had repented before the great destruction come upon you. But behold, ye are gone, and thy Father, yea, the eternal Father of heaven, knoweth your state, and he doeth with you according to his justice and mercy. The people had once been a fair and peaceful and prosperous people. They had rejected Christ and fell into the influence of Satan. Satan's path always leads to sorrow and destruction, the sorrow of an empire caused from war. Mormon says that his sorrows will not bring them back. The people had great potential but did not return to Christ. I read this passage of scriptures that says corruption must soon put upon incorruptible bodies, and it makes me think about the potential and my family's potential. We must do more and become better. The glory of exaltation is the reward. The great plan of happiness was designed for us to become immortal and exalted. Satan envies that portion of the plan. Mormon says, oh, that ye had repented before this great destruction had come upon you. Why do civilizations collapse? This collapse follows a logical sequence: power, political and economic forces, and self-fulfilling prophecy. Self-referential thinking is rarely acknowledged in the competitive and limited resources of control. The fair ones were gone, subject to the justice and mercy of the Eternal Father, a powerful lamentation of the consequence of sin and war.